those who don't know me, I'm Reverend Margaret Middleton, and I'm a retired minister, and I worship in this congregation.
Oh no, not an Easter egg hunt in church. Yes, an Easter egg hunt in church. There are 12 unusual Easter eggs hidden. So can all the children in the church, they are within the zones of here to there and then there and there. It is not in the children's ministry area. So you've got to come out and help find these eggs. I think there are five of you, so you need to find a couple each. If you find more than two and a half, then could you please share them? Annie, do you want to help Grayson come and find some eggs? And they are not what you might expect for eggs. Has anybody found one already? Yes? Can you hold it up? Woohoo! Bring it up to the front. We'll put them on the front. Here we go. Have we got 12? Are you sitting next to one that you can see, all ages people? And you might want to hold it up in the air for people who don't want to scramble through all the people. Where can you see one, Andy? Okay. Come on, bring them up to the front. We're going to use these to tell the story, and don't go away. This is an evil plot to get you up. Oh, you found one each. Good. Bring them here. Then don't go away. Are there any more? How many have we got? Should we count? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There are, to make up 12, 5 more. Oh my goodness, Dash, you're on audiovisual, aren't you? Be creative and think where audiovisual is. Look at that. Go and have a look by the end of the cross. I tried to color code them so they would hide. Yes. So 2, 4, 6, 7, 8. 4 more. Thank you, thank you. 2 more. 1 more. And 1 more. Okay, kids, we're going to tell the story of Easter using these eggs. So you want to go back there, that's fine. Can you pull the piece of paper out of there? Can you pull the piece of paper out of there? Can you pull the piece of paper out of there? Can you help Grayson pull? What's inside the eggs? Not chocolate. Oh, why isn't there chocolate? Well, have a look over there. There will be chocolate later, and I've even got some chocolate that you should be able to eat. What does this one say?
Empty tomb.
Empty tomb. Where's that going to fit at the Easter story? The beginning or the end, do you think? The end, and that's where we've got all ages talk. So we've got the empty tomb. What's this one?
Palm branch.
Palm branches. That's part of Easter. When did we do palm branches? Last week. If it's empty, we'll put it back, and I'll use that for next year. Palm branches at the beginning. What have you got? Crown of thorns. And for those of you who haven't been close to the front, we have a crown of thorns here on the cross. Okay, crown of thorns somewhere in the middle. What else have we got? We have a spear. Thank you. Ooh, do we know where that goes? Somewhere near the crown of thorns. Have we got all? Can you get that one out of there for me, please? Piece of paper. Bread and wine, where does that go? At the beginning, after the palm branches, or before it? After. We have the cross. Yes, that goes probably after the crown of thorns and before the spear. What do we got here? Strips of linen. Towards the end, before the empty tomb or after the empty tomb? After the empty tomb. Boom, de, boom, boom, boom. Don't worry about the numbers. Oh, we got more. We got more. Can you unpack these for me, please? And I'll do one, seeing I'm here. In fact, we got more than that. Can you do that? What have you got there?
Towel.
Towel. Think hard. Near the bread and the wine. Yes, where's the bread and the wine? Towel. There we go. And what have I got? I've got stone. Yes, well done, Lily. Stone, empty tomb. What have you got there? What's the picture?
Flowers.
And you find flowers in a? In a garden. So the garden would go near the tomb, before or after the bread and wine? After the bread and wine. And we've got 30 pieces of silver. After the red wine, before or after the garden? Before the garden, there we go. And rope. I had to think really hard about this one. Rope, rope. After the garden, near the cross. I think it goes before the crown of thorns. So have we got all of them? Have we got 12? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. We're going to tell the story. Can you help me tell the story a little bit? So the palm branches, because Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey when nobody was allowed to ride anything. Don't tell me he was humble, please. It was Jesus riding in on a donkey for celebrating of Passover. And then they went into the upper room. And there was a towel there because Jesus did what to his disciples' feet? Washed his disciples' feet and dried them with a towel. And then he blessed the bread and the wine and shared them, and that's why we have communion, to remember that. Then there were 30 pieces of silver, which was the price that Judas got for betraying Jesus. Ooh. And Jesus went out to the garden to pray. And his disciples turned up and they all fell asleep. That sounds normal, yes. And then there was some rope. Who would they have tied up? Jesus got tied up, yeah. And they didn't just tie him up, they bed him up and they put a crown of thorns. Who would like to wear a crown of thorns? I'll tell your mum you said that. Crown of thorns is absolutely nasty. They were pretending he was a king without realizing he was the king of us all. And then they put him on a cross, which is the most horrible way to die. But they did. And then the other people there were taking too long to die, and they sent them, go and hurry it up. But they discovered that Jesus was already dead. It would have been lovely, but he's alive for us today. But he was dead, and we know because they stuck a spear into him, and water and blood came out separated. And that only happens When you're alive, the water and your blood stays together. But if you ever go donate blood, you'll know about the difference between the watery blood and the red blood. So after he had died, they took him away and put him in a tomb. And what did they put on the front of the tomb? A stone. And would it have been this big? This big? This big? This big? Probably. Enough to cover the front of the tomb. So the stone was there, put there by the Roman soldiers who were very strong. Okay, and when the Mary came and discovered the stone had been rolled away, and she said, oh, where's he gone? They've taken Jesus away because the tomb was empty except for the strips of linen. They stayed and they had folded up the bit that goes on the head, which is a very Jewish way of saying it is finished. So that's the whole story of Easter. Woohoo! I want to pray a little prayer. Thank you, God, that you have let us celebrate Easter. Thank you, Jesus, that we are celebrating your death and your resurrection. And bless us this Eastertide that we might be a blessing for each other. And everybody said, amen. Right, all people who are near my... Now, that doesn't work anymore because you're taller than me now. There are activities out. Can we gather in the foyer, the eating foyer area, and we will be eating. Okay.
Mark reading 16:1-8, also the New International Version. Jesus has risen. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side. And they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid.
Thank you, Margot, for bringing us the reading, and to the music people for bringing us such wonderful music this morning. It's always a joy to have you leading us. Well, one morning last week, I was captivated by a piece of dramatic yet exciting music being played on classic ABC. It's usually on in our house most mornings. Usually stops me from doing a lot of things too. And this particular piece stopped me. It was called The Dream of Flight and was part four of a series called Civilization. And wanting to hear it again, I went to my computer and found it on YouTube Music and listened to it once more with a greater appreciation because the words set to the music were also there to follow. So easy. But just think for a moment of all the technological advances that allowed me to do that. You see, we live in a world that has changed so much since human beings dreamed of flying, it makes your head swim. Well, mine does sometimes. YouTube, information in the cloud, solar energy, battery cars, miracle life-saving operations, and now AI. And that's not to mention ventures into outer space beyond the moon. So how then do we come to understand things that are beyond our computer knowledge and all our scientific investigations? This morning, we're celebrating the greatest event that the world has ever had to deal with. Jesus, a Galilean Jew, humiliated, brutally killed by crucifixion, the Roman Empire's method of killing those who try to subvert their power, buried in a sealed tomb so his followers could not steal the body. This same person raised to new life by God. Resurrection. Jesus alive, not in the same form as his family and friends and followers knew him, but alive, risen, undeniably the one they had lived with, talked with, prayed with, laughed and enjoyed life with, the one they had watched heal the sick and calm a storm and raise the dead. And in Mark, yes, the women see the empty tomb. I think I've missed a page here somewhere. I did. Well, let me go backwards. Yeah. I was talking about the one that they had seen, the one they knew so well, and the very one that they had believed was the Christ, God's Messiah, the promised one who'd lead them into a new kingdom, the man they had failed, betrayed, and watched die. Alive. For nearly 2,000 years and more, people have pondered the story, and we have minds to dissect, to probe and analyse. And can we analyse, probe and dissect this story also? Well, people have tried. Even Google will have a go. And there are some who say that the language of the Gospels which describe the resurrection of Jesus is the language of poetry, and that as such cannot be taken literally, that it points to a truth more profound than the literal. And very often, I think, this is the way the Bible is written. And some of the stories of the birth of Jesus, for instance, are good examples. But in the case of the resurrection, I really don't think that applies. Why? Because there really is no story about resurrection in the New Testament, except in the most fragmentary way. It's not described at all. There's no poetry about it. Instead, it is simply proclaimed as fact. He is alive. The first gospel written, the Gospel of Mark, has a very brief comment about this cosmic event, as Margot read to us. There's only a mysterious messenger who issues a promise and a command, an empty tomb and a group of terrified women who flee, too frightened to speak. Now, you're probably thinking, no, that's not how it happened. But in Mark, that is how it happened. Each of the other gospel writers share at least two pieces of evidence as proof of a miracle. Witnesses to the empty tomb and appearances of the risen Christ to multiple followers. In Mark, yes, the women see the tomb is empty, apart from the messenger, but nobody gets to see Jesus or touch the nail holes in his hands in Mark's story. There's no great commission, as in Matthew. There's no recounting the Hebrew scriptures or shared meals with travellers to Emmaus, as in Luke. No intimate conversation with Mary in the garden, nor any mysterious arrival of the risen Christ behind locked doors, as in John. Apparently, Mark's good news requires no resurrection proofs evidenced by encounters between Jesus and his disciples. But instead, there is a promise. He is going ahead of you, and there you will see, going ahead of you to Galilee, and there you will see him just as he told you. And that's it. We don't even know if they did. In Mark, the resurrected Jesus is not described as being with you. He is described as going ahead of you. Going ahead of you. Mark's brief but simple statement is indicating the profound belief that death is now stripped of its power. The messenger at the empty tomb issues an Easter command and promise. Don't be alarmed. Jesus said this would happen. Look, Jesus was truly dead, as you can see from the place they laid him, but death cannot hold him. So, in other words, there is nothing Jesus' followers will endure, no place they can go that Jesus isn't already there. Jesus is absent, but he has not abandoned his followers. He is ahead of them, and he is ahead of us. And that's the ending of Mark's gospel. Now, if you're thinking that the ending of Mark's gospel is very strange, well, you are in good company. It is strange. So strange that many believe there was more to it in its original state, but somehow the ending got lost. And so, if you check your Bible, you'll find a new ending just to make sure that we have it all rounded off beautifully. However, I'm inclined to agree with those who suggest that its unexpected, abrupt ending is just as Mark wrote it. Don't be alarmed, he's saying. Look, go, tell. The way of Jesus, according to Mark, is a way of mystery and paradox, and always had been right through his whole life. Mark is saying, look, look at the cross, look at the empty tomb. God's Messiah is crucified, and yet he lives. Terror and amazement silence the women, and yet somehow, the good news is proclaimed. The disciples are nowhere to be found. And yet they carry the ministry of Jesus to Galilee and beyond. Go. Go away from this place of death and of endings and return to life and new beginnings. And then tell. Tell the disciples, even and most especially the one who betrayed him, that he is going ahead of you. You will see him. Among those with shattered lives who long to be made whole, the followers of Jesus will see him just as they did in Galilee. He will continue to go ahead of you and lead you. So what then are we to make of Mark's story of Jesus' resurrection? Does it help in our understanding of this miracle, which is central to our Christian faith? Will we try to reduce it to poetry anyway and have Easter eggs to signify new life and flowers to talk of new hope, the birth of hope in a despairing soul? Well, yes, these are all miracles in their own way, but they are not this miracle. So what are we to make of this story? The more important question, I believe, is not what we will make of the story, but what we will do as we hear Mark tell us, don't be alarmed, look, go and tell. Tell that Christ is risen, that he is to be found among the living ahead of us, still leading us, his followers, leading us into mission, still leading us away from hopelessness and death into new life. That he is still ahead of us, showing that the way of love, of peace, and justice in our strange new world of computers and digital technology and miracle cures and AI, that the way of love, the way of God's kingdom, will never be defeated by the power of this world, however or wherever it is to be found. Because of the resurrection, we can say, as Desmond Tutu so eloquently put it, goodness is stronger than evil. Love is stronger than hate. Light is stronger than darkness. Life is stronger than death. Victory is ours through him who loved us. And yes, it's not easy to be hopeful in the face of entrenched poverty or division or climate warming or drug addiction or violence or cynicism or others' hopelessness. It's not easy to love when our hearts are often empty or dried up or judgmental and we struggle to know ourselves. It's not easy to proclaim life when all around us is the evidence of people and things we love dying. Our church, our friends, children trapped in poverty, crime or warfare, maybe even the planet itself. And yet our hope, our love, our life is well founded, for it is founded on the one who overcame death, decay and despair in order that we might live abundantly and eternally. So, on this resurrection day, despite all the unanswered questions, hear the invitation. Look, go, tell the good news. And as we do, we will have come full circle back to the opening of the gospel where Mark writes, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Alleluia. Amen.
Thank you.
now have our prayers for others. Thanks, Anne.
Let us pray. God of the bright morning star, God of the rising sun, God of darkness banished, we praise and worship you for empty tombs, thank you. For disciples running with good news, thank you. We celebrate your victory over death, over all the powers that would defeat us. Help us grasp resurrection to understand its power, to see its force at work in our world, overturning evil empires, changing hatred within us, moving the world slowly, forcefully, bending us towards love and truth. On this day of great gladness, empower us to be your ambassadors, proclaiming good news in our kitchens and living rooms, good news in the offices and workshops, good news in the fields and factories. Help us to be that good news, walking softly on the good earth, caring gently for all people, living hopefully into your kingdom. Today we think of all those who are grieving and the sick and dying. And we pray for all those on our prayer list here in Tuggeranong. For places in the world that are torn by war and bloodshed, Gaza, Ukraine, Yemen. In this world of broken hopes and dreams, we catch sight of your kingdom come in the person of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns in us forever. Amen. Please join together in the prayer that the Lord Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Well, let's sing our final official hymn, Yours Be the Glory, Risen Conquering Son.
Thank you.
go joyfully now in the power of the Spirit to be resurrection people. People not afraid to go and tell the good news. Christ is alive. He is going ahead of you. And may the peace, the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, make you strong to do your best in every good thing, working in you that which is delightful in God's eyes. And the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and life-giving Spirit, be with you now and forever. Amen.